Hello there. Welcome to our online service. My name's Dan. I'm the trainee minister of Grace Church, Haworth Heath. Whether you are a regular member of our church family, or whether you aren't really a regular churchgoer at all and you're just having a look at what church online means and what it looks like, you are all very welcome. It's great, isn't it? Even in a time of disruption, we can gather together online in our living rooms or in our bedrooms to pray and to sing and to hear God's word read and taught. We've got such a good God who gives us the technology to be able to keep on doing that. I don't know what your week's been like, whether it's been a week full of manic busyness because work hasn't calmed down yet, whether the week's been feeling a bit sluggish because there's just nothing to do, or whether you're somewhere in between, whether you're feeling happy or low. Well, whatever your week's been like, all of us, as we come to worship God and to hear his word to us, we need to quiet our hearts. We need to prepare ourselves to come and be with the Lord. And so we're going to do this now as we just take a moment, maybe in prayer or in reflection, just to be silent and prepare to meet with God. I've got here a calendar I found around the house. It's my mum's calendar. She sticks it up in the kitchen. It's got all these funny little jokes about what it's like to be a mum and how difficult it is. But it's a calendar from 2018. That's 2 years ago. I don't know if you could think back to 2 years ago. What were you planning? What were you hoping for? Back in 2018, did any of us think that we'd be spending 2020 locked inside our houses? This is a good reminder that even though we might make plans and even though we might have great hopes for the future, actually we're not ultimately in control of our lives, are we? Something like the coronavirus hits and all the plans of 2018 for the next few years get disrupted. We're not in control of time or of our plans ultimately, but God is. That's a great reminder for us today that God is in control of all of history and his plans happen according to his timing. In our New Testament passage later from Luke's Gospel, we're going to run into a woman who's been bleeding for a number of years. And she is left in that state until she meets Jesus. It happens in God's timing and she's wonderfully healed, but according to God's timing. Many of us might feel like our lives have been disrupted at the moment, but we know that God is still in control and he is working out all things according to his timing and his plan. I'm going to say a prayer for us as we begin our service. Heavenly Father, thank you that you are the sovereign over all of history, that you are in charge, and you work out everything according to your good timing. Lord, we confess that we find it hard to trust in you when things are difficult. When things don't go according to our plan and our timing, Lord, we find that really tough. We admit that sometimes we choose to trust in other things, even ourselves, rather than waiting for you to do what you want to do. Father, thank you that you forgive us even those times we don't trust in you. Thank you that for those who are trusting in Jesus, there is forgiveness for every sin, even sins of the heart and sins where we find it difficult to trust. We pray now that you would meet with us by your Spirit. Please would he produce more faith in us, patience and a willingness to wait for you, wait for your plan to come about. And Father, we pray that you would do this in us graciously as we gather to worship you today. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to hand over to our musicians. We're going to sing two songs, and the first one is Be Strong and Courageous. Having just spoken about how sometimes our plans get disrupted, sometimes we can feel like, oh, it's all really tough, but this song is an encouragement for us to be strong and courageous. Not because we can fix it, but to be strong and courageous in faith because God can fix it and he holds all of his people in his hands like his children. So I'm going to hand over to the musicians. If you're at home, stand up and sing out loud as we worship the Lord together.
Well, let's stand and sing this song, Be Strong and Courageous, which borrows from God's words to Joshua at the beginning of Joshua, reminding him to be strong and courageous, even though he faces many problems. And we face many problems, including sickness at the moment. And so we pray that God will be with us, and we know that Jesus has indeed conquered them all. So let's stand and sing this song together.
Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Do not fear the fire, do not fear the water, do not fear the thunder. Jesus has conquered them all. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Do not fear the darkness, do not fear the sadness, do not fear the sickness. Jesus has conquered them all. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Do not fear the enemy, do not fear the poverty, do not fear eternity. Them all. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe by his side. Be strong and courageous, the Lord of the ages holds all his little ones safe. Holds all his little ones safe. Never ceasing, call for voice of loudest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of God's redeeming love. Hitherto thy love has blessed me, you have brought me to this place, and I hope by your good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He to rescue me from danger interposed his precious blood.
To know that even though we can't gather physically, at the same time everyone in our church is singing praises and worship to God in their homes. Why don't we take a moment together to pray out prayers of thanksgiving, of praise, of worship to God, and then we'll move on with our service. So let's take a moment to pray out in our homes together. Cool. Well, please bring those prayers to a close. We're going to have an interview now with Sarah, one of the members of our church. So I'm going to move on to that. Well, hi, Sarah. How are you doing? A couple of weeks ago, we had an interview with Paul because him and Adele had just had baby Judah. And we thought we'd interview Sarah today. Sarah, could you tell us a little bit about yourself? Tell us about your family, your job.
Yep. Hi, everyone. So I'm Sarah. Most of you already know that. I'm from Shrewsbury in Shropshire in the Midlands originally. And I moved down to London when I qualified as a nurse to get 1 year's experience in London. And that was 10 years ago. Never went home. I met my husband, Ed, at university. And when he finished his master's, he moved down as well. So we lived in Raynes Park near Wimbledon for about 4 years, and then bought our house in Bolnall a couple of years ago. And that's when I started attending Grace Church. We had our daughter Isla 15 months ago. And Grace Church is like our family, really, because all of our family are up north. So it's great to have you guys around. Obviously not seeing anyone from church in lockdown either, but it's nice to still do these things. So when I first moved to London, I worked as a paediatric nurse at Chelsea Westminster Hospital in General Peds. And then about 8 years ago, I moved to the Royal Marsden in Sutton, which is a cancer specialist hospital. So I'm now a clinical nurse specialist for children and young people with solid tumours. It's a bit of a mouthful. Basically, what it means is I act as a key worker for patients with, so between the age of 1 and 24 years, with any solid tumour that's cancerous outside of the brain. So I kind of plan their care, support them, usually in hospital, but virtually now, and kind of deal with any problems that they might have, really.
Cool. Thanks for that. Lovely to have a couple of Northerners in the church, because I lived up north for 4 years, beautiful part of the world. So you say you've obviously had a lot of time in at the Marsden in Sutton, and you work for the NHS. We're hearing a lot in the news about how hard it is for the NHS. Could you give us kind of a picture of what it's like on the ground? Because obviously you've been there at the moment with COVID-19, and obviously the people you're dealing with must be pretty vulnerable. So could you just give us an idea of what it's like on the ground?
Yeah, completely. So, right, my patients are really vulnerable. They've all got weakened immune systems because of their chemo or radiotherapy. And so they're going through a pretty nightmare time as it is without coronavirus arriving on the scene. I think it was difficult initially for us healthcare workers, because parents and patients obviously were phoning, really anxious, understandably, and we've never had to deal with anything like this before in the NHS, certainly in our lifetime. So getting the information to the patients was quite anxious for the staff as well, because it's new for us, and getting that information filtered down to us was difficult, and we all just want to do the right thing, obviously, by the patients. I think it's important to say that the front line, people think of nurses in intensive care and things, which is obviously true, but everybody in the NHS, all healthcare professionals, their jobs have completely changed at the moment. So it's a challenge on every level for everybody. But in true NHS style, I feel like teams have pulled together. We're really looking out for our colleagues, trying to adapt as much as we can, trying to give care as much as we can. Completely differently, but like my patients are still receiving their cancer treatment, which is great for them, just in a different way, which we're all trying to manage. I think staffing levels are a problem. So if any healthcare professional or anyone that they live with shows symptoms, then they can't work until they're proved negative. The staff testing is much improved, so that's something to be thankful for, but it's very variable across the NHS as a whole of who's getting tested, how long the results are coming back, taking to come back. So I know in the first few weeks in my trust, there were 750 staff members off just in one trust. Wow. So the impact that is having on the people that are remaining and trying to work and carry on and do the care is huge. So there's a number of challenges, and then obviously the personal protective equipment is proving a big challenge as well. So just really pray that there's more of that, and that it is just used by the people that really need it on the front line.
Well, thanks for giving us that picture. It sounds like a really tough place to be at the moment, and we've been praying a lot for our health workers. We'll continue to pray for them.
Thank you.
You mentioned, as you were telling us about your job, that you've been kind of put into isolation. Can you tell us how that's been? Why you're there quickly? And for you and Ed and Isla, how is it? What are some of the benefits and also some of the difficulties?
Yeah, so some people will be aware that the government sent out these shielding texts and letters at the beginning for extremely vulnerable people, like those that are having cancer treatment, etc. And then about 3 weeks later, they sent out another wave of letters, and I actually received one of those letters because I've been classified as having severe asthma. So although I'm really well, if I was to catch the coronavirus, then it could be really serious and potentially fatal. So it was a bit of an odd position. It is a bit of an odd position for me to be in, because I class myself as a key worker and I want to be there for my patients, etc. But after a lot of thought, conversation, prayer, I decided that I did need to put my own health and my family first. So I'm now shielding for potentially 12 weeks. Who knows really how long that will be, but I was very determined to still be able to do my job and to help my patients as much as I can. So the NHS isn't really designed to work from home, and certainly the IT system does not support such a thing. So after a lot of phone calls to IT and frustration, I am now up and running from home. I can contact my families, I'm calling them to touch base, and in a way I've got a bit more empathy with them, because we've shared tips on how to get priority delivery slots at the supermarkets, and the challenges of shielding and keeping young children at home, which I otherwise wouldn't have experienced. So I'm trying to draw those positives. It's great that I'm set up working. Ed and I, because Ed's obviously working from home as well.
Yeah.
And because of this, Isla can't go to nursery because she poses a risk to me.
Yeah, sure.
So we are doing two jobs and childcare like a lot of other families are. So it's just logistically challenging, tiring, and very long days. But we're getting in the swing of it.
Cool. I'm glad you guys are getting into the swing of it. So in a moment, I'll say a prayer for you. But just as we finish, just quickly, what are some of the things that we could possibly do to be supporting, I guess, the NHS and our workers, and also people who are stuck at home with small children, from your experience? So what are some of the things, just quickly, we could do practically to help, do you think?
I think the overwhelming feeling from NHS staff that are actually at work is probably tiredness bordering on exhaustion. Yeah. So I think just Grace Church have got some amazing cooks and bakers. I think just the food delivery service is fantastic from Grace Church. And if you are able to drop something on one of your friends' doorsteps, then just so they've got a hot meal at the end of a busy shift that they haven't had to think about, or that they know their family is fed and they don't have to do that, or a cake or even a bottle of wine to look forward to. And just even just if you can't go out, a text to say that you're thinking of them. Just so they know that they aren't forgotten and are appreciated. I think for young children, I don't have any great tips on that, other than just support each other like we're doing already. You know, we're all in the same boat. If you've got an activity that worked really well, then please share it on the WhatsApp. And just be there for each other, because we're all having the same frustrations. And I think community groups, and certainly Bethan's community group, is really good for that we can share, and I'm sure others are the same. So try and take some time, as difficult it is, for your adult self as well. And come to community group and vent.
Brill, thanks. And excellent little kind of shout out to Bethan's community group there at the end. Great. Sarah, thank you so much for taking the time out to chat to us. Do you mind if I say a prayer for you and Ed and Isla?
That'd be lovely, thanks.
Well, let me say a prayer for you guys. Father, we thank you so much for Sarah and for Ed and for Isla, for the connection they have with our church. Thank you that they're part of our family, that they have felt that. Thank you for keeping Sarah safe and the whole family. Lord, we pray for them as they have these 12 weeks in lockdown. Please help them to grow in love and patience and kindness to one another. Please help Isla with all of her rhythms being changed and not being able to go to play school. Please would you keep her healthy. Help Sarah and Ed as they try and balance two full-time jobs of looking after her. Please would love and kindness be very present in their homes. Lord, we pray for Sarah, please, as she works from home to support her patients. Would you help her, give her energy and the strength and love and joy that she needs? And indeed, Lord, we pray for all of our NHS staff in our church and across the country. Please would you sustain them. Please give them a strength that comes from you, fighting back exhaustion. Father, help us as a church to support those we know who are giving themselves so tirelessly and sacrificially. Father, please would we love others well. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Sarah, thank you so much for chatting. I'm going to hand over to Alex, who's going to continue to pray, to lead the church in our prayers. And then I'm going to hand over to Lauren, who's going to lead us on our New Testament reading. Sarah, have a lovely day. God bless. I'll hand over to Alex.
Let's pray. And as we begin, let's read a few verses from Psalm 82. The wicked know nothing. They understand nothing. They walk about in darkness. All the foundations of the earth are shaken. I said, you are gods. You are all sons of the Most High. But you die like mere men. You will fall like every other ruler. Rise up, O God. Judge the earth. For all the nations are your inheritance. Thank you, Lord, that you are a God of justice. Thank you that we see how you sovereignly rule the earth. May we remember this, even in the current situation, and trust in you.
Dear God, thank you for our mums and daddies. Please give them patience at difficult times as they home school us and work.
We pray for our leaders, especially Boris Johnson, as he fully returns after illness, as they consider the next stage of the process in managing the pandemic, in particular as they consider how we can begin to move out of lockdown. Give them wisdom as they seek to balance the various needs of different groups of people.
Thanks, dear God. Thank you for all the key workers, particularly those in the NHS and teachers. Please keep them safe as they work to help others. Help them as they make difficult decisions. Amen.
We thank you too that we're still able to meet virtually in various ways throughout the week and all our church family can get online. We lift up to you our various groups still meeting. For community groups and SALT, that even though not meeting physically together, they may continue to be places of close friendship and community, as well as learning together from your word. For prayer meetings, especially the longer monthly church one this week, and particularly at this time for the online Christianity Explored course starting soon, that a good number may be able to join that course and be touched by what they hear and learn through it. We thank you for new life in the midst of this pandemic, and this week especially we thank you for the safe arrival of baby Matthew to Paul's sister Emma, who used to be part of Grace Church, and Mike. We also continue to lift up Paul and Elle to you with baby Judah. As both these babies' lives begin in unusual times, we pray that you would be helping Emma, Mike, Paul and Adele as they seek to bring them up through their first few days in lockdown. So we ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Hi everyone. Today we're looking at Luke chapter 8 verses 40 to 56. I'll give you a moment to look that up in your Bible so you can follow along. Verse 40. Now when Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were all expecting him. Then a man named Jairus, a ruler of the synagogue, came and fell at Jesus' feet, pleading with him to come to his house, because his only daughter, a girl of about 12, was dying. As Jesus was on his way, the crowds almost crushed him, and a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years, but no one could heal her. She came up behind him and touched the edge of his cloak, and immediately her bleeding stopped. "Who touched me?" Jesus asked. When they all denied it, Peter said, "Master, the people are crowding and pressing against you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me. I know that power has gone out from me." Then the woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, came trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been instantly healed. Then he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace." While Jesus was still speaking, someone came from the house of Jairus, the synagogue leader. "Your daughter is dead," he said. "Don't bother the teacher anymore." Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid, just believe, and she will be healed." When he arrived at the house of Jairus, he did not let anyone go in with him except Peter, John, and James, and the child's father and mother. Meanwhile, all the people were wailing and mourning for her. "Stop wailing," Jesus said. "She is not dead, but asleep." They laughed at him, knowing that she was dead. But he took her by the hand and said, "My child, get up." Her spirit returned, and at once she stood up. Then Jesus said to them, "Give her something to eat." Her parents were astonished, but he ordered them not to tell anyone what had happened.
Well, hello, everyone. My name's John Hobbs. I'm the minister of Grace Church. It's great to welcome you if you're new or visiting us. Do keep coming back. Do share this with anyone you think would benefit from it. And for now, let's just say a prayer. We've got a great passage to look at, so relevant for us today. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. We get to come together each week. We get to be reminded of what's truly true through your word, the Bible. Teach us now about who Jesus is for us and what it is to put our trust in him. Amen. Well, I have to say, there's so much in this passage I would love to go through with you. So there is a longer sermon that you can get to if you click the link below this video at the end. But for now, let's just think a little bit about what we've got here. I've got three things. I've got a fireman's hat, very fetching. I've got a policeman's hat. I once wore one of these. And I've got a doctor's stethoscope. Now, which one of those three are you going to go to if you need someone to put out a fire? You're going to go to the fireman. What about if you need someone to arrest a burglar? You're going to go to the policeman. What about if you need someone to make you well? You're going to go to the doctor. Ba-boom, ba-boom. Each one of those people is able to do a very specific thing, aren't they? If you like, they're the only ones able to do it. And that helps us understand what we've got in our passage today. You see, what we're learning is that we trust in Jesus because he's the only one able to do what he can do. He's the only one able to do what he can do. Do you remember the last few weeks, a couple of weeks ago, we saw Jesus' power and authority when he was able to calm that storm? Remember the wind and the waves? He spoke a word and it was stilled. Last week, we looked at his power and authority to cast out all evil. Just a word, and a man was set free. Well, today, we see his power and authority to deal with disease and death. And don't we need to hear that one? He comes back to Capernaum and there's lots of crowds waiting for him. And a man called Jairus, who sort of heads up like a Jewish church we call a synagogue, fights his way through. You see, Jairus is sad. He's got only one daughter. She's just 12 years old and she's so sick that she's almost dead. He asks Jesus to come and heal her and he's delighted Jesus is willing to go. But then suddenly it's all frustrating again because on the way a woman stops Jesus. She's just touched the edge of his cloak for healing herself. She's got a horrible bleeding illness. And do you know what happens? The moment she touches his cloak, she's healed immediately. Amazing. But because of the delay, well, it's tragic. A man comes and says that Jairus' daughter has died. But you know what? Jesus speaks the most amazing words to him. They're in the passage we had read in verse 50. So kids, have a look with your parents now and tell them what Jesus says to Jairus in verse 50. Go on, have a look at it now. Well, did you see it? Hearing this, Jesus said to Jairus, "Don't be afraid, just believe and she will be healed." Don't be afraid, just believe and she will be healed. When he gets to the house, he goes in with his disciples and mum and dad. He takes her by the hand. He speaks a word and she comes alive. So well, she's able to eat food. Now, kids, I reckon it's probably quite a hard thing for your parents to get you out of bed this morning. That you might put your head under the pillow, you might push them away. No, no more school. They might have to pull the duvet off in the end. Well, Jesus says about this little girl, he says she's not dead, she's asleep, because that's how easy it is for him to raise her from death. Easier than it is for your parents to get you out of bed. He just speaks that word. Well, we trust firemen to put out fires, don't we? We trust policemen to arrest burglars. We trust, what was the third one? Doctors to heal us when sick. Well, Jesus is able to do anything, even to deal with disease and death. And he wants us to trust him because he's the only one able to do what he can do. He's the only one able to do what he can do. Well, before we finish, here's two things we need to take on board if we are to trust him. The first the passage puts before us is we need to feel our need. We need to feel our need. Didn't Jairus and the woman feel theirs? Jairus knew his daughter was close to death, so he knew he needed Jesus. The woman had tried for 12 years, all sorts of doctors, they couldn't heal her, and so she knew her need as well. Could it be the fact we don't think enough about Jesus? We don't always look first to him. Could it be that we don't feel our need? Well, if it's worrying about sickness, we all need him to raise us from the dead. We all need him to be at work, perhaps, in healing us now. But it's not always that, is it? Kids, you might get really frustrated sometimes that you're not able to please Jesus or please your parents. You just keep getting stuff wrong. It keeps causing arguments at home. Well, there we need Jesus to help us now, don't we? To help us overcome sin. We need Jesus to forgive us too. We need Jesus in so many different ways, don't we? Well, if we are to put our trust in him, we need to feel our need. But it's not just that. We don't just need to feel our need. We need to know his power. We need to know Jesus' power. That's the big thing throughout this event, isn't it? No doctors could help the woman, but just a little touch of Jesus' cloak and she's healed. Jairus could do nothing about his daughter, but just a word from Jesus and she's raised. It's that easy for Jesus to deal with the problems we might have in life and especially our death. Now, he doesn't always do it according to our timings, just as he didn't do it according to Jairus's. We may have to struggle for a while. We may have to struggle until finally he raises us from the dead. But he is well able to do what we need him to do. At Grace Church, we often say what we call the Apostles' Creed. The beginning is all about belief in God who made everything, the Father, Jesus the Son, and then the Holy Spirit. But after that, we find a number of different phrases that we're believing in. We're believing in the Holy and Universal Church, the communion of saints, which is the community of all us as God's people, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection body, and the everlasting life. Well, look, how are we going to trust Jesus for these things? By feeling our need of them and knowing his power to deliver them. Yeah, to make us holy, to give us that place amongst his people in this life and the next, to forgive whatever we do wrong, to one day raise us from the dead and give us this everlasting life in a world made perfect. A story is told of a father watching his son out in the garden. Son's very small and he's just trying to lift this big, big rock. He can't do it. And in the end, well, he's really frustrated. The little boy sits down, head in his hands, almost in tears. Well, dad goes out and he says, son, are you struggling to move that rock? Yes, dad, the boy says. Dad says, look, son, have you used all the strength available to you? Yes, dad, he says. And then dad looks kindly at him and says, son, you've not asked me to help, have you? Can you see the point? Jesus' strength is available to us with the rocks that we just can't shift ourselves. Are we ready to ask him? Are we ready to live that instinctive life of prayer, feeling our need, knowing his power, and therefore pleading with him as the woman and as Jairus did, through faith, trusting him to give. That's God's word to us this Sunday. Well, there's much, much more to be said. As I mentioned earlier, do click on the link and let's spend some time thinking about this in some depth. But for now, why don't we say a prayer and give God thanks for this. Gracious God and Father, thank you so, so much that Jesus' power is available for us as we put our trust in him. Help us, Lord God, to feel our need, to know his power, and therefore to trust him. And to trust him in all the struggles of life. And we ask it in his precious name. Amen. Well, it's been great looking at that with you. We're going to spend some time singing in response, as we always do. So I'm going to pass back to the musicians now, and they will lead us.
Service. I hope you've been encouraged and that the Lord has spoken to you and we're driven to more faith in him. Having worshipped and having heard from his word, why don't we say the words of the Lord's Prayer together. So let's pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Well, if you'd like to engage with more of what we do as a church throughout the week, you can check out the link below in the description. Our community groups, our youth groups are still meeting. We've got videos going up on this YouTube channel helping encourage Christians, and for those who are not yet Christians, to give an opportunity to learn more about the Christian faith. So if you'd like to keep engaging with what we're doing as a church, please do that. Please get in touch with one of us if you'd like to talk more. As we go into our weeks, a final blessing. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Let's go this week to serve and love the Lord. God bless you. Have a great week.